So we're here, and thank you so much for giving up your time to speak to me, Nicolette. I feel very honoured to have you. And of course, we were hoping to be doing this in person, as you were due to come over for the Oxford Rural Farming Conference, which unfortunately ended up being an online event due to ongoing pandemic problems. But here we are. Here we are in our virtual form, and it's very kind of you. I think I should probably let you introduce yourself rather than me trying to.
Well, thank you for inviting me, first of all. And yes, I would have loved to have been there in person. And I've been doing some speeches. I was in Florida earlier this month, and I was in Virginia just last week. So I have continued to be out there, but it is challenging right now with the pandemic. So I'm happy that we could still be together in a virtual space. And I'm hoping to be in England this summer. So I'll hopefully see a lot of folks that are listening to this in person. So my background, I'm speaking to you from our ranch in California, north of San Francisco. And I call myself a rancher because I do spend some of my day every day doing things to help out on the ranch. And there were about 7 years where I worked full time on the ranch. I was really our main ranch hand. I would not say ranch manager or anything like that, because I was just doing what I was told, you know. My skill level wouldn't merit the term manager, but I was helping out a lot for several years. But I'm originally from Michigan, which is from the middle of the United States, kind of the upper Midwest. And I was not reared, on a farm. My parents were both professors at the university in Kalamazoo, Michigan, where I grew up. And I went to law school and I became a lawyer. And then I started working for some environmental groups. And it was at that time that I had a very strong passion for environmental issues that I'd had my whole life. And I was working for Robert F. Kennedy Jr. And he wanted me specifically to focus on pollution from the meat industry in the United States, because there was there were so many areas of the US where you had agricultural areas, rural areas that were populated by farmers, but where you had large confinement, sort of modern, what I would call industrial animal production, move into the area. And so it was actually primarily farmers and other rural people, but really farmers that were, whose lives were being completely upended by these big industrial animal operations that were coming in.
Is this what we call a feedlot? They were
polluting waters and, pardon me?
Is this what you'd call a feedlot?
Yeah, well, the feedlot is usually a term that we would use to say something that's outdoors, like where cattle are finished or fed grain. But we would just call them, some people say factory farms. I prefer to say industrial operations, but they're large, sort of metal buildings. They look like warehouses. Right. If you were to drive past one, you wouldn't know what it was. In fact, normally, people wouldn't, unless you could smell it, which is often the case.
Wow. Okay.
But it's very lifeless. There's no sort of activity around it other than it's quite automated. And you may have, the ones I was visiting were primarily in Missouri and North Carolina when I began working there. And there were, thousands of pigs in each of these buildings, in striking contrast to a traditional farm that would have had maybe 20 sows or maybe 50. That would have been a lot. Mm-hmm. But now you had thousands per building, and you'd have many of these buildings in a row. So it was very industrial in its appearance. And I began working on this with Robert F. Kennedy Jr.'s group called Waterkeeper Alliance. And I did that full time for 2 years as an environmental lawyer, sort of trying to fight the pollution from these operations, which are essentially unregulated in the United States, because there's an environmental law saying you can't pollute the waters. And it actually explicitly applied to these operations, but the law was not being enforced.
Okay.
So our job, we were trying to get the law enforced. So that's how I got into this work. And then I very quickly thought, we need to support good animal raising too, not just fight the stuff we think is problematic. And I began searching out good examples, and very quickly became connected with the people from the Niman Ranch Network, which was a network of several hundred farmers and ranchers that were all following practices that were designed to maximize, ecological sustainability and animal health and animal welfare. And the the basis of it was primarily grass. You know, the animals should be on grass, but there was a lot more to it. But it was, you know, about good husbandry, good stewardship. And I met Bill Niman, who's the founder of the whole organization. And he was also the CEO. And to sort of compress a very long story into a very short story, we got married, fell in love, got married, and I moved from New York to California. And I was obviously still an environmental lawyer and a vegetarian. I didn't mention that yet. So that's another interesting part of my background. And Bill's a very open-minded person. I have to give him a lot of credit for this. When we first met, I told him, or somehow it came out in conversation that I was a vegetarian. And he said, oh, yes, I know lots of vegetarians. That was his whole response. He had no, you know, judgment or, oh, gosh, that's so terrible. Or why are you not eating meat? You know, he just was like, oh, okay.
That's no okay. Problem. Yeah.
Yeah. And we got married. And in fact, we've been married for 18 years. And for the first 16 years, I didn't eat meat. So it just recently converted to back to eating meat again. And I was really 33 recently. Years as a vegetarian. So I have a lot of thoughts about all of that. You know, I'm sure we'll get into that in the conversation.
Yeah, but well, so I was too. Unusual for 5 years as well.
Yes. No, I know. I remember you saying that. And actually, interestingly, very often when I meet people in the kind of regenerative food space, sometimes on the farming side too, but more so on the food side of it, there are people who are really passionate about the way food is produced, and especially the way animals are raised. Mm-hmm. And then I'll find out that for a number of years, they were either vegan or vegetarian. Right. So I think those are often the people that are really grappling with this issue, and they come around to this idea of kind of omnivory.
Yeah.
Is the right choice for themselves.
Omnivory, yeah.
But they can really see both sides of the argument. And so I had this kind of unusual background, and then I began writing books about meat and livestock production and how it's done. And I produced a book called Righteous Pork Chop about 12 years ago. And then about 8 years ago, I wrote a book called Defending Beef, because I thought beef really needed a good defense. The beef industry was doing a terrible job just defending itself.
You were fully vegetarian when you wrote Defending Beef.
Yes, and Righteous Pork Chop as well. And then I was asked by the publisher to write a new version because, you know, there's just so much public conversation about this. And I spent a whole year going through the book line by line, making sure that I still felt that that was accurate and reflected my current thinking. And I changed it quite a lot. So there's a new Defending Beef. And when I wrote that book, I was eating meat again, but it wasn't until that most recent version of the book that I started, you know, I was an omnivore again.
That's incredible. I'm really surprised because, you know, before we started recording today, we were talking a little bit about the differences between the two versions. And I had no idea that the first one was written as a vegetarian and the second one was written as an omnivore I think this is a great sort of segue into you telling us what the differences between the two versions are. For those that don't know, and anyone, just read it. It's pretty much a manifesto for regenerative agriculture. But you know, as the subline says, the case for sustainable meat production. What's the differences? What are the major differences between the two versions?
Well, and I'll tell you, the new version has a wonderful subtagline. I liked the original version too, but I think the new one is even better. It's the case for ecological, the ecological and nutritional case for meat is actually what it is, verbatim. That's what the subtitle is. So it says basically there's a case to be made for it, you know? And so it's not just about defending, it's also building the case, which I like that new subtitle a lot. So I think you just said, what is the primary difference between the two? Is that the question you just asked me?
Yes, please, yeah.
Yeah, so there is that. There's the fact that I was, you know, writing it as a vegetarian and then writing it as an omnivore. In some ways, that does change the book because my original idea was that, you know, if you choose to eat meat, it's a good choice if you're choosing well. Mm-hmm. You know, and I always say, you know, I just recently had a great conversation with Patrick Holden of Sustainable Food Trust as part of the Oxford Real Farming Conference. And in that, I said, you know, one thing is I would have said maybe 10 years ago, if you can't get really good meat, probably not better, you know, better just don't eat meat at all. And that's, you know, that's the perspective of a vegetarian, right? And now having returned to omnivory, I'm more and more concerned about this idea that we're telling people who can't afford or feel that they can't afford really high quality meat, that they shouldn't be eating meat. And I actually don't believe that. I think it's so nutritionally valuable that what I said to Patrick in that conversation, and I really believe this, and I've thought more about this since I said that to him, and I really believe this, is that you should try to seek out the best food you can afford. And that would include meat. So, you know, the most, the best farmed, the, you know, the least processed, the most local. I mean, there are lots of different parameters on which to try. And I think all of us, we all know, you know, I'm standing here in my kitchen talking to you. I cook food every day. I do a ton of foraging. We, you know, on our own ranch, but also in our community for other food from other farms. We barter with local fishermen to get good fish. Amazing. I mean, I put a lot of time into my food, but I know that if we opened up my cabinets and we went through there, we would find stuff that is quite imperfect, right? In terms of the standard that I think we all want to be trying to uphold. So I don't want to suggest you need to be perfect. My idea is for all of us, do the best you can, you know, get the best you can find, the most healthful, the most supportive of our regenerative food system, the one that's going to provide you the best nutrition, et cetera. And so I would say the same thing about meat. So there is that shift in the book. I think I shifted away from, you know, this idea that, you know, eat good meat or no meat. I didn't really say that in the book, but there was sort of maybe some implicit thought to that effect. And the other thing is, it's just a less diametric kind of conversation. So I had a lot of feeling that we needed to rehabilitate the reputation of meat and the importance of the animals in the food system, especially the grazing animals. And that we were hearing a lot about veganism and plant-based, and we all need to do that. And I want to make the case, well, not necessarily, you know, and the animals are very important ecologically, and they're very important nutritionally. But I didn't, I was sort of couching it all in terms of eating a plant-based diet versus eating meat. And more, I have come to believe that the real question is essentially, you know, how real is your food? How unprocessed? Mm-hmm. How close to wild food is it? How much biological vibrancy does your food have? That sounds a little, maybe,
how linked to the soil is it?
Pardon me? Yes, exactly. Is it coming from
the earth? Yeah.
How connected to nature and natural processes? The book that especially helped me really, you know, bring this into focus was Dr. Fred Provenza's book, Nourishment. And he's a doctor in the sense of a PhD. He's not a medical doctor. And he spent three decades studying animal nutrition, especially ruminant nutrition. And he did these extraordinary studies where he would take groups of sheep. And he did this for decades. So it wasn't just one study. He did a lot of studies, a lot of replication, and a lot of different forms of the same study, where he would take a group of sheep, withdraw their blood in the morning, just take a little blood sample, and then look at their blood samples and evaluate it, release the sheep out for grazing, observe what they individually grazed during the day, take a blood sample at the end of the day.
Wow.
Okay. And he did a bunch of these studies, and basically the findings were pretty strong and pretty consistent. And they were this. First of all, no sheep would eat the same thing from one day to the next.
Wow.
Secondly, no sheep would eat the same thing as the sheep next to it. It was very individual and very specific. Hmm. And here's the most extraordinary part of it. He found consistently that if there was a deficiency in the animal's blood, so take, for example, calcium.
Sure.
Let's say that an animal had a low calcium level, like to the point where it would be deficient. Consistently, over and over again, for decades, he found in research that that individual sheep with the low calcium level would seek out plants that had a lot of calcium in them and would actually self-rectify the deficiency by the end of that day. And they would take the blood in the evening and find that the calcium deficiency had been rectified. Now, that's extraordinary,
that's
right?
Incredible.
We don't know this. We all think that, especially as humans, we think we're so smart, but we know that every wild animal knows what to eat, right? And Dr. Fred Provenza's work was to show that domesticated animals had this same ability. He calls it nutritional wisdom. And then he makes the argument in his book that we all have this same capacity ourselves. We humans do. And so the more processed your food is, the more disconnected it is from nature, as we were just talking about, or even disconnected from the soils, the less your own physiology is able to recognize what it contains and how to, you know, how to, what it's providing your body. And in fact, the less it will actually contain that your body needs, right? Yes. Because he talks a lot about these secondary compounds, things like tannins that are contained in plants that the plant has to defend itself against other, like insect pests, for example. And those, it turns out, he argues, they're incredibly important for human health. And so if you eat like a processed food, even something like pasta, which we don't tend to think of as junk food, right? But it is a highly processed food. That will not contain any of those secondary compounds, the naturally occurring chemicals that he believes are incredibly important for long-term health. So the new Defending Beef book was influenced by a lot of these kinds of things I was reading about. And it's made me think that we need to have as much of our diet as possible connected to natural processes and foods that our own physiology has developed over millions of years to recognize and to support our health. So that's kind of the, you know, the quick version of what has happened in my thinking. I mean, there's a lot more to it than that, but that's the thumbnail version of how the book has changed and how my thinking has evolved.
So it sounds like anyone who's read the original version should probably then get something out of the second version as well. Is it there's a significant shift in there?
And also I went through, because I think the book is very useful, I had designed it to be something that if you're a farmer or a chef or even just a consumer and you were having conversations with people, for example, a lot of chefs had told me years back, my husband Bill Niman works with a lot of chefs, he always has. So I was meeting a lot of them and they were actually telling me that they were being challenged quite regularly. You know, why do you even have beef on the menu? Okay. So it was this idea that people were kind of like, and they were struggling to articulate why they felt, you know, grazing animals were important and beef was good food. And so I thought, I want a farmer who's raising cattle. I want a consumer who's eating beef and feels that that's the right thing to do, but is not sure how to fully explain it to the cousin or the aunt or the, you know, younger nephew or niece that's challenging them. It was trying to pull together the arguments in favor of why this is a really important part of the food system and part of the human diet.
So the argument has shifted from defending beef to defending natural food in some way.
Sort of, yeah, real food. I think the word I would use is real food because I like to contrast it with food that is highly processed. Yeah. And also, it's interesting, for the talks I've just been doing over the last few weeks, I did a lot of additional research and reading and thinking about how I wanted to frame all this. And I realized that another piece of it is just, what kinds of breeds and varieties are we creating in the modern agricultural system? Most of them are, whether you're talking about, again, plant or animal, it's not so much of a dichotomy between these two things. It's how close is it to something that would have been a food similar to a food that would have been found in nature that we evolved with. So if it's a modern variety of a chicken, a tomato, or an apple, and it's a fast growing variety that's designed to be able to be, you know, raised and, you know, processed and gotten to the consumer and, you know, and make that whole part of the growing shorter and then make the shelf life longer, right? Yep. Which is how so much of modern food is produced. Even if it's a whole food, if it's something that's been not necessarily genetically modified even, although that's a whole other matter.
Bred. Yeah.
Yes, a variety that was created without respect to taste and nutrition. Okay, and that's pretty much all modern food, sadly. So it's kind of a greater call, right, to seeking out, for all of us, including myself, you know, I've shifted a lot about how I gather food, how, you know, what kind, even just in my own garden, I try to use older varieties of seeds. I try to make sure that I include foraged foods, you know, things like not just fungi, we do a lot of foraging around here for fungi, but also, you know, wild herbs and wildly occurring lettuces and things. We eat those kinds of things as well. And I try to include that in our daily diet to try to make sure we're getting some of these really important naturally occurring chemicals that are absolutely absent in processed food and largely absent even from sort of whole foods that you would find in a grocery store. So it's like, it's a sort of this call that I'm feeling and that I want to share with others to try to get back to foods that our body knows what to do with and that really support long-term health so that we're not all, you know, you turn 50 and you start taking a medication and then 52 years old, you start taking your second medication. And by the time you're 65, you're taking five medicines every day for the rest of your life. You know what I mean?
This is
what we start to think is normal. And I don't think it's normal.
No, or necessary. I completely agree. And it sounds like what you're talking about is actually reconnecting our own gut biome with nature's biome. It's connecting our guts with the soil, with the earth. And there's a large transfer of information that can happen when we eat like that. And I completely agree with you. I see with animal husbandry, obviously in the States, you have a huge variety of different landscapes and climates. And when people are growing plants and animals that are not native to that environment, they're often chosen, as you said, for rapid growth and shelf life and not for taste and nutrition. The longer an animal or a plant lives on where it is, the more nutrition it's going to contain when we consume it.
That's a good point. Just that specificity of the human diet. I mean, we have, if you look at cultures, this is another idea that's been out there for a long time that, I mean, especially in the industrialized world, we're told that there's one healthy way to eat. You know, in the US, we have this food pyramid that we were told for decades by our Department of Agriculture. This is how you should eat. You know, so at the bottom
grains,
of the pyramid,
grains, then veg, then meat, then
right, grains, and then you just want a tiny bit of oils, which is so bizarre because actually fat is absolutely essential to good health. And if you eat real whole fats, it's totally healthy food. There's nothing wrong with it. And in fact, you know, one of the things I often encounter people believing is some people have begun to accept this idea that fat is not necessarily bad for you, but they'll be like, oh yeah, the fat that's in an avocado or a walnut is okay for me, or even maybe coconut oil, but any other fat, definitely all animal fat is bad for you.
Yeah.
I don't believe that. You know, I think if it's a food that we evolved with, such as real whole animal fats mm-hmm. from all the grazing animals for sure, especially if they were on grass, that contains a lot of nourishment right there. The secondary compounds I was talking about before are found in the fats largely.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, olive oil is fine too. I'm not totally saying you shouldn't be eating, you know, plant-based fats,
there's a difference within plant-based fats. And funnily enough, right. I had a conversation this morning with a nutritionist talking about this very thing.
Yeah,
and he said, people tell me coconut olive oil and avocado oils are great, but they're not seed oils, they're fruit oils, because those three oils are derived from fruits, not seeds. And he was making a clear distinction between plant-based fruit oils and plant-based seed oils. And plant-based seed oils are something that didn't exist until 1910. And it was processing from the cotton industry by Procter & Gamble, who tried to make candles from cottonseed oil, and they hydrogenated it. And when they did, they said, hey, hang on, this stuff looks like lard. It looks like cooking oil. Let's give it to people. We can make money. And it was called Crisco.
Yes.
That's the
Crisco
one. Yeah. And so started this hideous experiment of feeding seed oils to humans. And, you know, we sort of had a chat this morning with this amazing guy, Tim Rees, and he was explaining to me how these oxidized oils are already spoiled. They're already oxidized by the time we start using them, which is why they have a shelf life, because they've already gone bad. They've been broken up by chemical processes. And it's a terrible experiment done on humans. My great-grandparents rather, in the UK, the only oils they would have had to cook with would have been lard, tallow, and butter. That's it.
Right. And exactly.
Fats and oils are essential to human health.
Exactly.
So there is this terrible experiment that has happened in the last 110 years, which is not doing us any favors with seed oils.
Right. And again, actually, in the new version of Defending Beef, I talk more about this very issue, because I was invited by Sustainable Food Trust. They did a big conference here in the United States near San Francisco. And I chaired a panel at their invitation about fats. And I learned a lot more about this, exactly the kinds of history you're talking about. And the fact that, here's something that I had never thought about. Patrick Holden said, we're living off of the fat of their land. And I thought, wow. He always has a great way of putting things.
Yeah, he's great at like catchphrases and summing things up.
Catchphrases are so important, right? Like my favorite one, it's not the cow, it's the how, which I have brilliant. To say over and over again. And it just summarizes all of my work, basically.
Annoying when someone does it that well.
I know. It's like, oh my gosh, how did you come up with that? But it was a beautiful moment, because I sort of knew in my gut, not to make too many puns here, but I knew that there was something wrong with my oil coming from, sort of industrial processes that were from farm fields far away. And maybe even, in the case of palm oil, from a region that had been a pristine Asian tropical forest and was being mowed down to create a palm plantation. And this is what we talked about in this panel, how we had been sort of convinced, we in the industrialized world had been convinced that we needed to stop eating animal fats. And that created a demand for these vegetable fats, in addition to the fact that there were these industrial processes So this whole issue of the fats is another part of the question. And I'm increasingly convinced that if it's a fat that you could create yourself, by growing the plant or animal and making the fat, or if it's something you could get from your neighboring farm, or it's something you could get in your community. So if it's butter, if it's schmaltz, lard, or tallow, definitely I would include olive oil as well. And actually, we live in California, so there are a lot of people in our community that raise olives to make oil. And so it is actually something you could do locally here and is being done locally, but it's not an industrial product.
Yeah.
And so it hasn't gone through all those stages, as you were saying, whereby before you even open up the bottle, it's probably something that is problematic for your body's physiology.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Your own health. So I'm sort of getting people thinking about local fats. That's another one of my
local fats. I like that. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's a good one. I'm going to try and think about how. No, it's something that as a business, I really like to find somebody who can actually take some of the trim and the waste from our whole carcass butchery and actually make a product that people can use. Because I think people have lost the will and the knowledge to know how to take trim off a pork belly that they might not know what to do with and actually just render it down and use it to cook with. So it would be great to try and sort of include that, because obviously the fats from pastured animals are different to the fats from industrial animals. And something really resonated earlier when you were talking about telling people not to eat meat unless it was 100% organic and grass pasture raised, and how your messages softened a bit on that because of the nutrition. And that's something that I agree with you on. And I sometimes advise people that if you're dubious about the provenance of the meat you're eating, have the leanest cuts you can find. And if you know the provenance is very good, go for the fattiest, luxury, go for the ribeye, don't have the fillet, go for the, the slow cooking bits with all the collagen and gelatin and the fats that are going to render out. And the same with pork, if it's pasture-raised pork that's been fed a really natural diet, use the fat, render it, cook with it for the next week and keep it. And if you're not sure, then eat the lean bits, because it's probably on balance the right way around.
That's an interesting idea. And I had never thought of it like that, but that's probably true, because most of the substances of concern, whether it's, perhaps hormones or other, other things that might've been fed or used in production that are problematic, for ecological health, environmental health, human health, will be found in the fats of the animal. And so, the better the provenance of the animal, the better the quality of the fat, and the more healthful. And it's going to contain those secondary compounds things like ALA and CLA, you know, all these various different compounds and types of fats that are being identified, recently identified, and they're found in grass-fed meats. They're really not found at all, or in very low levels in conventionally raised meats.
Yeah, that's the big, where the big difference is, isn't it? Yeah. Can we talk a little bit about how all the different food systems kind of fit together? Because when I was, as you know, in a funny way, the campaign of Regenuary started out as a pretty much, I don't mind admitting, a direct attack on Veganuary. I wrote it angrily because I saw Veganuary promoting a KFC burger being promoted for Veganuary. And that's really what prompted the whole idea of Regenuary, is to make people think differently. And I wrote a very scathing piece after a big glass of wine, and it was quite a bit ranty and a bit angry. But it provoked a lot of conversation, and that original piece had a million impressions on Facebook. And now in the third year of the campaign, I thought, in a very similar way to your new edition of the book, I thought, I don't want to alienate people who have a different diet. And as an omnivore, I also eat most of the same things that vegans eat, minus the replacements. So how can I make this more of a campaign about regeneration than arguing against veganism versus omnivore? And I did a fair bit of research. I tried to research how to be a regenerative vegan, and I wrote an article that I put on our website. And I tried to do it from almost the other side of the fence. I tried to counter-argue myself, but the conclusion I came to was that the only way that veganic agriculture can't really work on scale, because the nutrients aren't processed quickly enough through composting. Whereas a cow is essentially a lawnmower, a compost machine, and a muck spreader all in one unit that does it in 24 hours. And when you take the passage through a digestive system out of the equation, you have to make compost, ferments, and teas, and then manually spread that on the land, which is how veganic agriculture works. The conclusion I came to was that the only way people could be a regenerative or even a sustainable vegan is if other people are farming animals and other people are regenerative or sustainable omnivores. Does that sort of resonate with you as well?
Oh, absolutely. For a couple of reasons. I had so many thoughts as you were speaking, so let me try to think of a few of them. First of all, we have a wonderful vegetable farm in our community that is not just really good in terms of its practices. The person who started the farm, Warren Weber, was one of the founders of the California Certified Organic Farmers Association. So he's been very into this idea of healthy soils and creating healthy food for a long, long time. But he's always used chicken manure on his farm forever, and still does. And you know what? I bet you a lot of vegans buy their greens at his farm, because not only are they extremely nourishing, they're beautiful and delicious.
And really tastes great.
Good food, right? And so it just, to me, it's just a great sort of local example of how these, you know, even the production of plants and animal, you know, or rather vegetables and fruits are very closely linked. But as you say, there's an effort to say, well, we don't have to do it that way. We can do it another way. But as you also pointed out, the role of the grazing animal especially is really to hasten biological decay, and not just to hasten it, but also to add all kinds of beneficial things in that appear in the manure.
Complexity.
Yeah. Pardon me?
Complexity, because of
exposure
to different microbiome.
Exactly. It's all about those microorganisms that live in the cow's gut. And then there's a lot of microbiology in the manure. And so, you know, it's really a living organism that's having a tremendous impact on its ecosystem. And when well managed, it's a positive, type of impact. And of course, a living organism can also have a negative impact on, you know, a system. And I think when cattle, you know, just as I said, I was just talking to farmers all this past week, and we kept having the same conversation where I had a co-lecturer who was a soil scientist, and we were going around and speaking to different groups of farmers. It was very, very interesting week, actually. And we kept both, we sort of, our messages melded more as the week went by, and we came up with these little phrases we were using from each other. And we both, he said, I really like Nicolette's, you know, phrase, it's not the cow, it's the how. But remember, the how part is you all, you know, you're the managers. You're the okay. A cow is a poor land manager. A human does that role. Okay. And so it's really the cattle and all the grazing animals play an incredibly important ecological role, but it's up to the human managers of
those manage it correctly. Yeah.
To make sure that the impact is positive and is favorable and is optimized. Yeah. And another thing I wanted to say, this is just a small point, but I just wanted to insert this because I've been thinking about this a lot in recent months. When we talk about cows as kind of out there mowing the vegetation, I think the research of Dr. Fred Provenza shows us why they're not just mindless mowing machines. They actually are able to go out and select the vegetation that they need for their health. So to me, that shows the uniqueness of the living animal in the food system. They actually are in sync with their living environment. Mm-hmm. And they play an essential role. They're like, you know, it's like there's this puzzle. And if we think about how the earth evolved, there were huge populations of grazing animals on the earth, you know, and not that distant of the past. And they're gone now, you know, this sort of absent megafauna that was once here, the ghosts of the megafauna, you know, and I think Alan Savory makes this argument so well, so effectively. It's really the domesticated grazing animal, especially cattle, that can replace that disappeared wild animal. And so that ecological impact, that role that it plays ecologically is something you cannot replace.
Right? There's a mutualism. Grasslands cannot thrive without grazing animals, and grazing animals cannot thrive without grasslands. The two are inseparable in a sense. And the difference between the lawnmower and the cow is the cow, as you said, selectively eats parts, but also has enzymes in the saliva that stimulate plant growth. The pulling action of cows trying to eat will stimulate plant growth that a lawnmower won't do. Selective parts of the plant are eating that allow the light to penetrate deeper to the plants to stimulate extra growth. So that, I mean, we mow our lawns to make them grow faster, but we're not having the same effect as a sheep would or a cow would. Is that correct?
And they don't do that sort of cycling through the gut that we've been talking about, which is probably the most important thing that they do as far as creating biological diversity below ground.
Right.
And in Defending Beef, I talk about the fact that there's some very good research that's quite recent. In fact, I think some of the newer research I just added to the newer version, if I remember correctly, is showing specifically making the argument, some scientists in Europe and in China argued that the biological diversity of the soils is the single most important factor in determining the biodiversity above ground as well.
Right. So you start
with a biodiverse soil that leads to more diverse vegetation and more diversity in insect species. That leads to more, exactly, it's an upward cascade is the way I like to think of it. And so starting from that biologically vibrant and diverse soil, you end up with ecological health. And the cattle, the grazing animal, is incredibly important in creating that below ground biological activity and diversity.
Right, because of the complexity in the fermentation. Yeah. So if we want tasty, healthy vegetables, which are grown in the right place at the right time of year in the right way, we need animals to be part of that system, because in nature, there are no isolated systems where plants exist and animals exist in isolation from each other. We're looking to kind of recreate nature's systems. And I think...
And don't forget about the fungi.
And the fungi,
You need three. You need the three kingdoms. You need the plants, the animals, and the fungi. And I'm not just talking about mushrooms, you know, or turkey tail fungi, or, you know, porcinis.
But I'm the underground about network.
That subterranean environment, which is powered primarily by fungi. So we got to make sure we talk about all three components.
Yeah, there's an awful lot of information exchange and nutrient exchange happening beneath the soil through fungi, right?
And exactly.
Yeah, there was an amazing conversation I had with a a pharmacist turned soil biologist who is explaining to me how plants can communicate with each other through this network. And there was an experiment done where during a drought, one plant would start producing a waxy substance, and that would send that information to other plants, which would have a different response to drought by reducing the surface area of their leaves. And then the researcher found that when people ate those plants, we would sweat a little less because we were receiving information about this drought state through this transfer of information, which is
wow. That's amazing.
Extraordinary. I wish I could. I'll have to hit her up for the citation.
I hadn't heard about that. I've heard a lot. I've read a lot of the, you know, I've read Peter Wohlleben's books about the, you know, the secret life of the trees, and I've read Fantastic Fungi, and I've read a lot of, you know, and I've watched all of Paul Stamets's videos about, you know, about the importance of fungi in the subterranean world and so forth. I mean, there's just so much exciting research and thought, and I think we're just beginning to understand how the natural world functions. And actually, you know, as Peter Wohlleben argues, I think actually traditional cultures had a lot of the knowledge that we've lost, and we're rediscovering a lot of that knowledge. So it isn't that humanity was always in ignorance of these systems. It's more like in our modern times, we've abandoned that traditional wisdom that we had. And then of course we're discovering new things, you know, so it's sort of like we need to rediscover a lot of collective older wisdom that was, you know, garnered over centuries. And then we need to continue this amazing line, you know, all these amazing lines of scientific research that are showing, for example, this subterranean communication systems that trees have and other plants, and how they're able to. There's also a lot of research showing that if you have a bunch of plants, and I think I read about this in Fred Brevenz's book Nourishment, but if you have an attack by an insect, it will begin to respond to it, and it will also signal to the neighboring plants, hey, this attack is coming, and they will begin to produce the substance,
the chemical again.
They are made aware of the attacker by these other plants. It's extraordinary, right? Who knew this? Certainly ordinary citizens didn't know this. I mean, there were probably some scientists who knew this already a couple decades ago, but anyway,
it's amazing. Something incredible that comes out from that is the importance of doing as much as we can to not plow the land up.
Yeah.
Because then you're just destroying this entire communication network year after year after year, and turning the soil into an inert medium, which is effectively a hydroponic system by that stage. We're losing that information connectivity.
Exactly. There's a ton in Defending Beef making that very argument that we basically don't want to plow up the land because there's this extraordinary below ground environment that we want to keep it intact as much as possible. And actually, to go back to that, your point that you said you made in your article, that a small percentage of people could be totally vegan and still be regenerative, but you couldn't have a whole population. And I would have to completely agree with that, because to just sort of re-emphasize that point, about half of the Earth's land surface are places where we cannot grow crops. Right. And the vast majority, and that's according to Dr. Lynn Hunsinger, who's a rangeland scientist at Berkeley. She's a very respected scientist here in California. And it's really where the vast majority of the world's grazing animals are. They're on that type of land. And so what they're doing is they are sort of keeping open those open areas. And they're also keeping those below ground environments intact that have these elaborate connections, and especially in healthy grazing systems. So you can have degraded systems, you can have bad cropping systems, you can have poorly managed grazing systems. And so it's not all grazing that is equally beneficial. I argue, and this is what I believe that the science would show, that probably all grazing is better than no grazing, but there's a dramatic difference between the benefits of, and also you can basically completely avoid negative impacts and have sort of universally positive effects on an ecosystem where you have well-managed grazing.
So you've brought a really good point up there without probably quite realizing, but there's a lot of pressure and a lot of talk here in the UK where I think 2/3 of our agricultural land is not suitable for crops. It's marginal land, it's grazing land. It's either too steep, too wet, too rocky, whatever, or the wrong shape or elevation. And there's an awful lot of pressure I think through the media and through the general public who are sort of maybe semi-informed, and a little bit of knowledge is a more dangerous than a lot of knowledge. There's a lot of pressure towards rewilding as a way of preserving or improving to act as carbon sinks. And something that I have and will continue to argue is that regeneration happens quicker when managed than it does when left alone. Is that you can leave a system, particularly if we're talking, for example, about like a depleted arable crop field in the UK where we are, which has done, you know, decade after decade of barley, oats, you know, maize, sweet, whatever, potatoes and rapeseed or whatever. And it's tired. If you just simply leave that alone, it's going to take hundreds of years to rebalance, like hundreds with no, you just leave it alone. You just say whatever wild animals can walk across it and find it and let it do its thing. Because it's so out of balance, it's going to take a very, very long time to find balance again. Yet if we manage it through agriculture and we graze it and we plant it correctly and we give it a head start, we can dramatically accelerate that recovery. Is that something that you would agree with versus rewilding? But the other thing is it's not taking the land out of food production. We're getting calories from it as well.
Right. Well, I coincidentally, I just finished reading a few weeks ago, Isabella Tree's book, Wilding.
Right.
And I thought it was interesting because I posted something about it on Facebook. And I knew the book was somewhat, I was sure you would. I actually see a bunch of books that I know up there.
I am sure.
And that I love. But I thought one of the really key points, I am sort of surprised by how much her book is being regarded as an attack in certain agricultural circles, because to me, her book is a really strong argument for regenerative agriculture.
Right.
Because the key point that I think she makes over and again is, first of all, wilding land doesn't mean you just leave it and don't do anything to it.
Yes.
But that they did a tremendous amount. I mean, there's, you know, they did sort of countless things to try to, you know, improve how much biological activity was happening and increase the diversity and so forth. But also she makes a very strong argument, one of the strongest ones I've ever seen. First of all, that the grazing animal of sort of all shapes and sizes is absolutely essential to an ecosystem to function. And secondly, she just demolishes this idea in that book that Europe, including, you know, I know Brexit has happened, so I don't know if you call you guys Europe anymore, but the UK, okay.
Well,
UK,
we're still European. Yeah.
I know, it gets confusing for us Americans how to refer to you all. But anyway, so in Europe and including the UK, that there was this idea that this was sort of coast to coast forest canopy. She just demolishes that argument. Okay, she goes through it in incredible, powerful, scientific and logical details explaining why that's just a misconception. And that in fact, these grazing animals of all shapes and sizes. So like she includes geese in that, for example, or, you know, other types, lots of different shapes and sizes of grazing animals, but that they were essential in terms of how the ecosystem evolved and how it needs to be there to function. So to me, she made a very powerful argument for a regenerative kind of agriculture that has lots of diversity and has lots of animals in it. And sort of pairing it up with Gabe Brown's argument, and I see Gabe Brown's book on your shelf there, I think. He wrote this wonderful book, Dirt to Soil, but he basically says, he went from a just very simple system of two crops, soy and corn, and sort of chemical amendments, and just that was it. A very simple monocultural type crop, almost monocultural. And he turned it into a very complex system. And the thing that he says, and I've read his book and I've met him a number of times, and I've also watched a bunch of his lectures. And he says repeatedly that the more diversity added to his systems and the more animals he added to the farm, the more biological health there was in the whole system. There was more carbon in the soil. There was more biological diversity in the soils, and just the whole system was more productive and more, and really importantly, more profitable. So I think there's a tremendous parallel between Gabe Brown's work and Isabella Tree's book, basically just arguing, to me, the bottom line is trying to understand nature's systems and trying to work as they do and figuring out how to do that on your individual piece of land. And that, that will be very, very different from right. one part of the country to the other, or even down the road, depending, like we are right near the Pacific Ocean here. And our sort of micro ecosystem here is quite different from one just 10 miles inland from where we are. Very different, in fact. Right. So you have to be very site specific. You have to know your land. You have to listen to your land and look at your land, observe it, be out on it as much as possible. Learn about the history and the culture of your land and how, you know, what it's meant to look like, how it's meant to function, and try mm-hmm. to make the agricultural operation reflect that. So those, to me, those are the lessons from Isabella Tree's books, not the idea that we should be taking farms out of agriculture.
I really disagree with that. Yeah, excellent. No, so there's a couple of things you said there, which I completely agree with you. But the complexity, it's something that Alan Savory talked about. The more complex a system, the more resilient to change it is. And that yeah. that is very opposite to a very simple monocrop system where the farmer's trying to control all the variables, but nature controls the variables bigger than we can. So if something shifts in nature, if there's a seasonal change and water doesn't turn up when expected or heat comes at the wrong time, the system is very brittle right. and it can't adapt. And the more complex it is, the more adaptations can happen. And I think, you know, we are in a time of changing climate, and some right. of it is caused by us, unarguably. And the only way we can really combat that is to make our agricultural systems as complex and rich and diverse as possible, because nature will adapt, nature will find a way much better than our reductionist approach can.
Exactly, very well said. And I just want to add one more thing from Gabe Brown, who's one of my favorite people. He's so good with words also. He also says that when he was conventionally farming, he was always thinking about what to kill every day. He was thinking about what plant to kill, what insect to kill, what fungus to kill, what, you know, rodent to kill, whatever. And that when he shifted to regeneration, you know, he over time, gradually, it was a gradual process, that he realized that his whole focus has shifted to celebrating the abundance of life.
What
so it's
to live? Yeah.
From killing to life. So again, it's rather than this diametrical thinking of, if you're eating plants, you're not killing stuff. And if you're eating animals, you're killing stuff. To me, it's a whole different matter.
So much more complicated.
One that is supporting life and is really life generating and producing healthy life for the human that's consuming it. And a great deal of plant-based foods, as we know, is produced in very life killing systems and doesn't support human life either.
That's a pretty wonderful place, I think, to wrap this up. And we are exactly at an hour. But I think I think we've gone full circle. I think we started with the point that you just wonderfully wrapped up with. Thank you very much. When are we going to see you in the UK? Are you coming over to Groundswell this year?
I think so. That's what we're trying to do. I hope so. It isn't all, you know, nailed down yet, but it looks like I will be. And when I come, I'm hoping to do some in-person events as well. So hopefully you and I can do something together.
I would love to meet you in real life and this summer when you're over. And is there anything that we can, beyond obviously this is the original version, but is there anything else we can plug for you or tell people about?
No, I just have to say everybody should read Dirt to Soil. Okay. it's my number one book.
Number one starting book.
Gabe Brown's book. It's an easy read. You can read it in a couple days. And it is, to me, it's one of the most important books that's been written about all these things we've been talking about the importance of regenerative agriculture and its connection to human health and ecological health. And I love it because it's so easy to read. And so I recommend it over and over again. So I certainly encourage people to read my book.
Somebody else's book.
Also that book. I love it so much.
Thank you very much, Nicolette.
Thank you.